Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, panelists, our keynote speaker, and our distinguished guests. Welcome to our Let's Build, Let's Talk Virtual Christmas Party 2020. Thank you for joining us for this, our last event of the year. It's been a tumultuous year, in and out of lockdown, and all of us having to navigate this new normal. I hope you're coping with this, and I'm glad you've made it to this evening. We're living in unprecedented times with the COVID pandemic and the Black Lives Matter movement. There's never been a time when caring for your neighbor has mattered more. And we know that statistically, lower income groups have been disproportionately affected by the pandemic. This has shone a light on the plight of both Afro-Caribbean and Asian communities living in the UK. We'll be investigating what this means for the future and whether there's a cultural shift that needs to be made by both the employer and employee. What choices are available in the workplace now and in the future? We should have a greater flexibility at work now that we've all been working at home. Embracing diversity in all its forms, whether it's race, gender, disability, age, or sexual orientation, must be easier to achieve now, you would think. Bringing all of our collective genius together to solve the challenges that we face now and in the year to come. Let's hear what our panelists have to say. My name is Annette Fisher, and I'm the founder and chair of Let's Build. I'm an architect and a designer. I was the first Black woman to be elected to the council, and I've been a RIBA vice president, and I was the first nominated RIBA presidential candidate in 2002, Black candidate. My practice have a global focus on community-led projects in the UK and mass low-cost housing in Nigeria. I've over 30 years in experience and have designed buildings internationally and led bid teams in the UK and abroad. And I am the moderator for this evening. Now, we've got a full program for you this evening, and we're going to have, at the end of the evening, we're going to have our closing by a surprise guest. So please stay tuned. Our topic is Architecture Getting Stronger with Diversity 2021. We have another amazing lineup of speakers and panelists. We have Femi Oresanya. He has over 20 years experience since joining HOK in 1999. Femi has acted as an architect and design manager for several prestigious projects. He's the sector leader for government and cultural projects, responsible for marketing and securing new commissions in this sector. Outside of work, he sits on the RIBA University Validation Panel. He's a part three part-time tutor at the Bartlett School of Architecture and a part three tutor at examiner at Cambridge University. He's also the interim chair of Architects for Change and an RIBA expert advisory group advising on aspects of inequality in the profession. More recently, he was elected to the RIBA Council for the first time this 2020. Sumita Singha is an award-winning architect, academic, and author with her own design practice, Ecologic, who has worked internationally. Her awards include the UIA UNESCO International Design Award, Women in Business Award at the House of Commons, and Atkins Inspire Award for Architecture. Sumita set up was the original founder for Architects for Change, the Equality Forum at the RIBA, and is past chair of Women in Architecture. She was elected to the RIBA Council in 2011 to 2014 and has served on many RIBA committees for over 20 years. She is a non-executive director of Moorfields NHS Foundation Trust, where she chairs the People and Workforce Committee and sits on the Capital Investment Projects and Quality Safety Committees. She's also a trustee of the Architects Benevolent Society and an accomplished writer and lecturer. She stood as a nominated RIBA presidential candidate this 2020. Cheryl Pilliner-Reeves is an RIBA sustainable architect and academic. She was an environmental consultant for the Francis Crick Institute, featured on Channel 4 and BBC TV 100K House, and has run her own practice for over 15 years whilst also teaching. Cheryl is passionate about interdisciplinary practice and taught on the civil engineering with architecture course at City University for a decade before becoming head of learning tree with Teddy London, a radically new higher education institution. Cheryl is also RIBA Part 3 examiner at the Architectural Association and founder of Archimake, an architecture and engineering academy for children. She's passionate about creating opportunities for young people in the built environment. Seyi Alabi is the director of Camprom Construction. He is a qualified architect who has taken the step of working on the other side of the profession for contractors initially in order to gain the right experience to qualify as an architect and has continued with the organization. He brings an alternative view, therefore, to our role as architects and is also a Let's Build committee member. Now to our wonderful keynote speaker, Sonia Watson. She is speaking with us for the second time. She presented at our event last December to a live audience. Then those were the days. Sonia is the chief executive of the Stephen Lawrence Charitable Trust. This will be her sixth year in the role and continues to be the driving force of the organization, bringing in close to $1 million in the pro bono support to refurbish the center and deliver workshops and events in support of young people. Sonia has been awarded an OBE for services to diversity in the Queen's Birthday Honours List in June 2019. And she's passionate about finding pathways to increase representation, especially for Afro-Caribbean and other ethnic minorities. She is our keynote speaker. And so over to you, Sonia.
Thank you. So I cannot quite believe that we are talking again in this way, living a life on Zoom for something which we managed to achieve in real life, and yet now this is real life, working in this way. So it's still fantastic to be here with everyone and to actually be able to host something like this. Annette is always the same driving force and has the same vigor as always when putting on these events and make sure that they are not only well attended but well attended by really impressive panelists, as is always the case. So I'm honored to be asked to do this again, because quite frankly, anyone on this panel could keynote. So I'm just praying they don't do better in their little short slots when we're doing Q&A, because we have a very esteemed group here. When I looked at this, the title of what we're talking about today, Architecture Getting Stronger with Diversity in 2021, I can't help ever to go back to what is now a more recent memory that we are being reminded of, is that 28 years ago, the young man by the name of Stephen Lawrence had an absolute determination, not a dream, a determination to become an architect. This is ever more poignant because we are now in 2020 and the extraordinary events of what we have all experienced, the perfect storm of what it looks like to live during COVID, also to be disproportionately affected by the very thing that we are all fighting supposedly together. And yet again, those from Black and minority ethnic backgrounds find themselves disproportionately affected. Young people are disproportionately affected by their choice of career in a profession within the built environment. And I'm looking forward to hearing the Q&A around that. But let's say a little bit about what we try to do at the Trust. And many of you already know this, but it's always good to remind ourselves of where that journey has come from. From Stephen's desire, we are now in a position where we have created 156 practicing architects throughout the country over the years, all of whom are practicing, and that if we don't think about architecture getting stronger in 2021, will change. We were overwhelmed and for a moment somewhat saddened by the impact disproportionately on careers and on aspirations that COVID brought about. It has meant that young people are in a position, through our experience, of perhaps not being given the appropriate opportunity to complete their studies. We have been super proud of many practices stepping up to support the young people who would have dropped out of their studies this year in particular, because of not only the disproportionate effect on their own career aspirations, but the disproportionate effect of their own families who were disproportionately affected by COVID. So here we are again, in a place where we see double and triple whammies coming our way. And that is what I believe we need to do something about. Now, before we thought about and had to consider responding very, very quickly to what happened to COVID. I was asked by the AJ, our esteemed Architects Journal, to rerun the 2018 race survey, which I commissioned with Richard Waite, again in 2020. Now, this was not only is it 2 years later, but here we were in the middle of COVID and we started the research before we saw the full effects. And for those of you who don't have the results, then of course, only ask me, or those of you who subscribe, if you haven't read it, then my goodness, you should. Because here we are 2 years later and we're asking ourselves, is architecture systemically racist and what is the profession going to do about it? That was the challenge in early July from the findings of the AJ's race survey, which actually shows that the profession has a seemingly worsening problem, creating and understanding what those obstacles are at every level for those from a non-traditional, low socioeconomic base. But we can say this now, all together now, we can say Black background, Black and minority ethnic. We don't have to find euphemisms anymore. This is something which we are all able to articulate and think about what can we do about those solutions. 1,300 UK-based respondents, so this is not an insignificant survey. 1,300 UK-based respondents replied to the poll, the second that was run in conjunction with us, and they suggest that we are seeing, again, something that needs to be worked on, and that's what we're here to discuss today, to think about what we can do differently in 2021. A couple of statistics for you that I think will provide incredible food for thought in the subject that we're discussing today. Of those 1,300, that racism is widespread in the architecture profession is up from 23% to close to 40% this year. Now, that is something which, of course, we can all discuss more. What do you think? Do you think it is there? Do you think it is not? Very clear questions that are answering. The survey also talked about respondents who were thinking about hurdles at every turn, both within and outside of practices, asked whether being Black and or from a minority ethnic group created barriers to career progression in the industry. 83% agreed to that statement 2 years ago, 91% this year. And we could go on, but it is much more interesting for us to hear the views of those who are on the panel as well. There are first steps to be made around sorting out. We've all discussed many times the sorting out of architectural education so that it is for the many and not the few. Now, we are a small, we believe significant, but nonetheless small charity working in this space, and others are trying to as well. This year, we have been overwhelmed by the support from practices. And I often say, are we asking the right questions of our practices in terms of actually supporting those who need it? Because when we have asked this year, we were overwhelmed by the support from over 92 practices who stepped up both financially and in other ways, including providing mental health support for those who are struggling to get through their education or who thought that they would not be able to graduate this year for various reasons. And yet still, would you recommend the architecture profession as a great career for everyone? Over 35% strongly agree. And so we must always temper these sorts of discussions with hope, because it is still a profession that is absolutely desired for those from all walks of life, and particularly, in fact, from those from minority backgrounds. And so what we're looking for is for social mobility to be no longer the scourge of society that we have now seen exacerbated with the advent of COVID this year. What I have found as well is that you simply don't see sufficient BAME representation in most university architecture departments. And so what does that mean in terms of how you move from education to getting an interview to actually thriving within practice? And that's something that we can all help our young people to achieve as well. But it is doable. We have managed to maintain the 28 young people who we actually make sure that we fund their education. And that was solely with the support of the public and of the professions and of individuals like those on this call to make sure that they could continue their education. And we are proud to do that. We have also found that this year, due to the increased support because of the death of George Floyd, we can guarantee their studies for the next, not 1 but 2 years, because that is something that we are absolutely committed to. And it is something that we know is making a difference, and we're proud to be able to do that. But what we look at, let's look at what it, where the hardest hit areas for BAME communities are, ensuring that progression in architectural education is there. 2020, we have to make sure that we increase even more. 12% of the workforce in the AJ100 define themselves as being from a Black or minority ethnic background. These statistics are not easy to find, but that is something which the AJ did that survey. And it's interesting, though, that 28.5% of students passing part one identify as BAME, and we can all do the maths. We have to make sure that those young people, we look at the gap. We're looking at 12.5%, and yet 28.5% are getting through part one against all the odds. And so where are we all together in terms of ensuring that they continue through? And I know, Femi, we've been on panels together where we're asking, what about your part two? What about stay for your part three? Keep going. Well, that is something that we all have to make sure. How does that happen? And how does that make sure that we get stronger? Work in the built environment has to be about ensuring that programs like our Building Futures programs and others that many others on this call are advocating do not slip away, because using a reason that is COVID becomes an excuse. There's the difference. We have to make sure that we lobby those who are able to ensure that we are supporting young people to get all the way through their education, and make sure that programs that are around social value projects, for example, that absolutely are being very, very categoric about making sure that there is a lasting impact on local communities when we are looking at design propositions, particularly if you are looking at urban regeneration. How can we make sure that we incubate young people who are practicing, whether that be they are entrepreneurially starting up their own practices? And we have today received this year an unprecedented amount of requests from large practices for the first time, because of, let's face it, the George Floyd situation. But let's understand that this can be a positive thing, and saying, can you put forward young people part two, or whether or not they may be in practice themselves for part three, because we would like to share this $1 billion project with them and make sure that, yes, we're looking at quid pro quo, let's be honest about it, because it's about ticking the diversity and the inclusion box. But at the same time, let's not pretend that this does not provide the appropriate level of opportunity meeting talent for young people who come from minority backgrounds. And so one of my areas for encouragement would be that we challenge those practices who are receiving some of these incredible commissions, that are challenging them to show where their diversity will be on their project teams, and that we grasp that metal and make sure that that is something that we are on top of. Because we have made a small start, and I'm always, always here to tell people about some of the projects that we're kicking off this year in that vein. But what I can tell you, it's a lot more than last year and a lot more than the year before. And we know why that is. It is because we are in a moment of zeitgeist. Whether we want to regard it as that or not, we must understand that this is a moment where being from a Black and minority ethnic background commands respect and commands opportunity in the built environment. And whether, however it comes, we must be ready to grasp that mettle. And so I am joined on this call by those of you who practice, those of you who I'm very proud to at least be aware of, if not know very well. And who are you bringing forward? Who are you bringing through who come from minority backgrounds, who are ready? Look at the numbers. Part one, 28.5% this year alone, and yet 12% are continuing on. So the drop-off continues to be unacceptable. Take ourselves back 28 years, and we have made progress. Earlier on the call in the introductory part, I was overhearing discussions about what we need to do around inclusion and to challenge that. But we have made progress because 28 years ago, we were around a 1.5% in terms of those who went on to practice. Now we're around about 12 who are registered to practice. That does not mean they are all functioning in a way that means that they can make a living, and we are doing our best to support those who are disproportionately affected, but we can do more. But we must also acknowledge that change has happened, and what can we do during 2021 to make sure that that continues to be the case? I was asked to respond to Black Lives Matter, and I talked about momentum being channeled into long-term change. The particular focus on supporting those who are age 13 and who would like to dare to dream all the way to 30, where they are perhaps thinking about how they can contribute in a real practical way and practice in the environment, is something which there is a window of opportunity that starts now and really opens up in 2021, which is about how can we make sure that all the access to that opportunity is something which we are all doing something to advocate. Because if we do not do that, then young people will still find themselves struggling with systems that are stacked against them. And is that seat at the table really that difficult? Are we really going to accept that we need another unconscious bias course to find out what we need to do when we are running multi-million pound practices, and even those that are not that way? I think we know what is necessary. Surveys like that, which has been repeated for the AJ, but also our own empirical research that we are all have an understanding of, means that we can and always and must do more. And it always speaks about us all coming together, and you always manage to bring together, even in light of challenging times for so many of us, but managing to bring everyone together to think about what is it that we can do differently to encourage long-standing relationships with key practices who have the power and the financial resources, and they have the large-scale projects that we should be thinking about. How can we open those up to those who are really thinking about this profession, and they are against all the odds, they have still decided that it is a profession that they wish to pursue. So how can we connect those people with the places and with those opportunities? We have to think about how we can do that even more, so that we are not, I don't want to be the premier face of providing opportunity, because I am talking to you in numbers that are way too small. This is something which we should be looking at the theory of change, which is much wider, more systemic, starts younger, and make sure that it closes all the gaps in terms of what we can do to provide opportunity. Because of course, what we do provides opportunity across a number of professions, but where we began and where our heart began was with one young man who wanted to be an architect. Through that, we have been able to offer that opportunity across a number of professions, and that is only set to grow in 2021. So when, like a phoenix rising, we come out of this journey that has become COVID, and that has become the challenge that it's brought to, I'm sure, many of you on this call. How can you challenge and how can you channel into long-term change something which has given us a moment? Because we have all got moments to reflect on what have we learned from this experience. Well, what we have learned is that architecture getting stronger in 2021 is something which is not going away, because systemically, organizationally, and in terms of the distribution of the wealth that is that are the projects, our seat at the table is here. What are we going to do to take that up and to prove that it should always be here and that is not going to be a moment? And how will we make sure that young students who might otherwise struggle to enter and complete that long journey make their way through? We have managed to work with 250 young people over the last 6 years, and 152 of them are practicing. That's not enough. And we now have that moment. I say it again because it's very important. See what rye comes out of the ashes of the experience of what we all know to be a very painful experience of reflecting on what happened all the way in the United States, but we had our own story here too, and not enough happened as a result of that. So if this is our moment, what can we do to make sure that 2021 is the year of architecture getting stronger, because diversity matters? I don't want to take up too much time, because I think it's really important that we get on to the Q&A, and of course I'll join in with that as well. But I think if it's always lovely to end with a call to action. And I talked about that there might be, and I'm sure you guys can come up with more, but there might be perhaps 8 steps that we think about when we're diversifying what we do. Some of it you will know, but let me pick out a few that we don't always think about. When you include staff, from when you're looking for staff in a recruitment process, one of the things that we've managed to do very successfully is partner with a recruitment firm who will make sure that opportunities that come our way are opened up to those from diverse backgrounds. That demand, since the tragic events of May the 25th, went up around 62% of practices asking us if we have any candidates who are from a Black or minority ethnic background. And so 21 will see that happen even more, because you all know about what to do to remove those artificial barriers, and we can all stand together to help achieve that. And I think I'll stop there. But 2021, getting stronger, why on earth not? This year it will be a moment and a real stake in the ground for those from minority backgrounds, whether we love the terminology or hate it. We all know who we are, and we all identify as those who fit within that category, if you like, and we deserve the same opportunity as has been afforded everywhere else. Leveling the playing field is more of a possibility than it ever has been before. Let's make it a probability in 2021. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sonia. That was brilliant. I think you've touched on some really important points about the dropout and our seat at the table. I like that. How we take up that mantle and move forward in the coming year. I'll move quickly on to Femi, who will give the next presentation, so that we'll run through all the panelists and then we'll take questions from the audience. Thanks,
Femi. Thank you. Elizabeth, am I going to run it or you're going to run it?
She's going to run it.
If you want to run it, you can. You're able
okay.
to.
Okay. Let's just see that. Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay, hopefully the first screen is just me. Hello, everybody. I'm not going to spend too long. I've got 5 minutes. So as Sonia has mentioned, this has been a strange year. Some people may call it a perfect storm, Annus Horribilis, but the fact of the matter is that the two main events that really affect our industry and our nation has been COVID. And unfortunately, the result is that some of us, you know, there are many of us who are lucky, but a number of individuals from Black and minority ethnic background would have been affected through the furlough scheme. Maybe also they've got families living in large households, all of the issues that Sonia has actually touched upon. And actually, you know, when the furlough scheme then came back with the dip in the economy and then the potential recession, there are a number of individuals who have since been made redundant. And that is the most upsetting thing, really. And then also, we then had that, okay? I'm not going to label it. May the 25th was the worst day of this year, those 8 minutes and 46 seconds. But out of that, good has happened. It has brought organizations to the table to start thinking, to start looking inwardly, how can we try to make our society better, okay? We are not there yet, okay? But I am an eternal optimist. I would not be in this world if I wasn't an optimist. And therefore, you know, I've been quite vocal, both in print and both on seminars. I've written many articles. I know we're doing it from the bottom up. You know, let's get the part ones in. Let's try and keep them employed. Let's try and support them. But ultimately, it's the people that run the businesses. Okay, we need to get them. I think we're now at that point when my fellow peers, the leaders, are inwardly looking at thinking, yeah, I have been privileged, okay? I didn't notice it before, okay? And yes, I've written about it. I've been very, very vocal. It needs to start at the top as well, because that's where the power is, you know? Yes, there needs to be more people like me that can speak truth to power. In the past, we did, but would we be listened? Probably not. Right now, we are being listened to. And the great thing there is, you know, I know that the RIBA is not perfect. Okay. It takes, and I know that my predecessors, you know, to try and get the RIBA to add the words systemic and racism in the same sentence, the chances of that happening, you might as well, you know, it wouldn't have. And, you know, I've got to give a lot of credit to someone like Alan, and we've met one-to-ones many times. The blog that he pushed out in September, which basically said, yes, we acknowledge, okay? Because in order to change, one has to accept, okay? And, you know, Alan did come out, he's put it on the blog. He could have just put it on the blog and moved on. But he's gone on record and he does want to be held to account. We are at the very beginning of those steps to trying to make a change. The event that took place shortly after his blog was an inclusion by design festival that looked at some of the areas of underrepresentation in our profession. You know, I attended all of them, and you know, there was one quote that just burnt right on the inside of my mind, which came from John Amici, which was, culture can be defined as the worst behavior tolerated. So leaders, you know, if you allow poor behavior to be tolerated within your organization, then we are not going to make that change. Shortly after that, the RIBA Inclusion Charter came out, which sought to say, okay, practices, we can't do this on our own. We're going to try and get our house in order. And they are, slowly. There are still issues. Something happened yesterday which really annoyed me. But they are trying. They employed an EDI consultant for the last 5 months who sought about trying to put together a strategy so that the RIBA themselves can try and sort out their own house. But by that same token, they are appealing to practices to also stand up and be counted. Many firms are already doing it. I can see Helen on this call. You know, Sonia's mentioned the uptake, the increase in inquiries. Okay, there are a number of organizations who are doing it, but we need to be more up there, more out there. So yes, you know, HOK plus a number of other firms were some of the original signatories for it. And I went on record, my managing principal backed me to the hilt and he supported, he signed it. I didn't sign it. Okay, I'm a principal in the firm. Yes, I have an interest, but when you get the top man of the firm saying, we are doing this, what are we going to do? Then it just basically emboldens everyone else within the organization. And yes, I am lucky. I work for HOK. Diversity is at the core of our being, okay? And yes, we go out, we do the hard yards, we go to the places, we try to support organizations like Neil and Sonia's. And, you know, we are going to do more of it, but we're not just thinking about just one of those work streams, which is, you know, the lack of BAME representation. And I'm still trying to find a proper term to use, you know, because we're not all just lumped up in one. I'm a black, British-born Nigerian. Sonia is a British-born West Indian. Neil is a British-born West Indian. We've got Sumita, who's, you know, who was born and raised and studied in Southern Asia. We are not all one. We all have our unique differences that bring. So I'm just going to talk about in these last few minutes of what we, HOK, are doing, and we are putting it out there. What I have done is I have set up a whole new committee within HOK that aligns with the RIBA's 7 work streams, okay? So that when we report back to the RIBA as part of our inclusion charter, we will be able to say, right, on LGBT, we have a leader. These are the things we're doing. On social mobility, which is the bit that I, you know, that's one of my hobby horses, because I think that cuts across all the other areas, you know, we've actually put some money aside, okay? We're looking for 17, 18-year-olds that want to go and study architecture, and we want to give them some money, but also we want to support them so that during their holiday, they can come and work at the firm and build up their experience and their portfolio. It doesn't mean that we'll see them all the way through to year 7, but hopefully by the time they want to move on, they have a body of work and a network in which to actually get more work and stay in our profession. Mental health and well-being, that's one of the other things which, you know, we're quite advanced on that. Religion and belief, believe it or not, it's something that's very rarely spoken about. But that could be one of the reasons why we're not getting the uptake, okay? And age and gender parity. Right now, our young up-and-coming professionals are probably those who have been most affected by this COVID. How do you learn when you're not sitting next to someone who will be able to just reel things off without even thinking about it? How do you learn by osmosis? And by that same token, we may be losing people who are, dare I say, ready to retire. Ensuring that we retain them so that they can pass that knowledge on, okay? BAME representation, which in a way covers all of those other elements as well. Ensuring that we go out, we find the schools, we have workshops in our offices, you know? We try to promote our diverse workforce. And as you rightly say, if you can't see it, you can't be it, you know? And me forcing these guys to step up, to put their, stick their heads above the parapet, because I can't do it by myself. Sonia can't do it by herself. All, everyone on this call cannot do it by themselves. But we have people within the industry who sometimes they're just so focused on doing the best job that they possibly can, they forget about the power of themselves, okay? And then finally on disability, you know, there is the obvious levels of disability, but what are the ones which are not so obvious? This is how we create a more diverse workforce. And that diversity, as I say, if we can actually be more diverse, cognitive, neurodiversity, you know, ethnic diversity, cultural diversity, gender diversity, imagine the architectural product that we can produce. So that's what I want to say. I am a glass half full man. We still have a long way to go, but I am positive that 2021 will be better than this year. Than the year before. Over to you, Annette.
Thank you so much, Femi. That was very heartfelt. And I do like that panel you set up at HOK. It gives that's a lovely model perhaps for some other firms. So moving swiftly on to Sumita now. Sumita, if you'd like to start your presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Annette, and thanks very much, Femi, for that wonderful, spirited presentation that you gave. So I just wanted to start by saying that last year at a Let's Build event, I said that unconscious bias is a major issue in the construction industry. But this year with COVID, we are seeing that bias has been responsible for the deaths of many, particularly those from the minority ethnic backgrounds. The term unconscious bias sounds really quite innocent and easy to overcome. Oh, I'll do a bit of unconscious bias training and I won't have any bias left. Or it's not my fault, it's only a bit of unconscious bias. But make no mistake, bias can kill. As a non-executive in the NHS and as an architect, I've become more aware of the bias embedded in our buildings and cities. Those who are the most vulnerable and those who have little money in the incoming global recession are the people that are going to suffer the most and have suffered the most. The majority of minority ethnic communities work in low-paid public-facing jobs, and many live in crowded homes in polluted areas, all of which contribute to ill health and the spread of lung diseases such as COVID-19. Worldwide, it will be poor people from Asia, Africa, Australia, and South America who will suffer the most from the effects of climate crisis. Again, the same people that we identify as minority ethnic communities in the UK and other white majority countries will be suffering injustice. Even more than before, I've become aware of the need to make our cities healthier and more equitable. So what is bias? It is the notion that some people are different to others, that some are superior to the other. Although there is no scientific basis to race, racism persists. And the feeling that some are the norm while others are, well, they are the other. Olu Ogyebe, Nigerian art historian, art curator, discussed notions of the other in his seminal work, In the Heart of Darkness. But what if this darkness isn't real? What if the other doesn't actually exist? African culture, much like Asian or South American culture, is valid and truly rich when it is considered on its own merit, instead of attempting to force it to fit Western ideals. There will always be ideas about the other. However, we can try to move past seeing what is outside of our own cultures as something to be feared and begin to appreciate otherness as a positive and beautiful thing. This is when unconscious bias lifts and something greater emerges. This year is the 20th anniversary of Architects for Change, the RIBA's equality forum that Femi mentioned. I was hoping that with the tragic murder of George Floyd and the Me Too movement, things might have changed. But I see from the sort of statistics that Sonia presented earlier on that more work is needed. Setting up campaigns and fighting those can be a very lonely task. I know. I spent 1 year working alone to set up Architects for Change, and then I invited others to join in. And it was very nice to have people around me who are fighting the same cause. So thank you to all my co-fighters on this journey. I know Helen's on the call somewhere, and Femi, who's the latest chair of Architects for Change, thank you so much for your support. Annette invited me to join Let's Build, and I recognize a kindred spirit, a fighter, a campaigner. Thank you, Annette. There are others in this group, all from different backgrounds that Femi mentioned, with different stories to tell. Thank you for letting me hear and share your experiences. Let's work together, let's share, and let's build. It was another journey to stand for the RIBA president this year. Although I didn't win, I was the runner-up. That gave me an inkling of hope that there is hope around the corner, perhaps. Another good thing that might have come from the COVID crisis is the hope that architects with lived experience of COVID and bias will be involved in the redesign of our buildings and cities. I don't want to see any more reports, roadmaps, and signing of various things. Let's just build. Let architecture get stronger through diversity in 2021. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Sumita. That was great. And I do like your parting comment about let's just get on with it. Let's not talk anymore. Let's just get on with it. Well, moving swiftly on to Cheryl Pilliner-Reeves, if you'd like to give your presentation now.
Thank you, Annette. Thank you. Well, it's quite something to follow up after those really inspiring presentations. I'm hoping I'm going to give a different slant on things slightly, because I'm really happy to give a positive outlook for 2021. I am definitely a glass half full kind of person, like Femi, and my buoyancy this year, getting through the worst parts of 2020, the most challenging parts, have been in the fact that I've been working in two environments which have been extremely inspiring and enjoyable, which is about education and educating people who have great potential to be contributing to the built environment. And without my input, I know they would never have realised their ability. And that really, you know, their enjoyment of what we've offered them and what we've helped them to find has what's made the whole year incredibly rewarding, despite of the huge challenging situations with the lockdown. So one organization, or the organization I'm with now, is Teddy London, and this organization is fantastically inspiring in that it's a startup university. And we're not looking at architecture in this example, but it's actually interdisciplinary engineering education. And I believe that the model they have is really beneficial, and it could really be something which could inspire architecture as well. So in terms of being inclusive, this is about kind of understanding how broad the built environment is, and what we can do and what we can share with each other to try to change things. So Teddy London is basically a new, completely radical type of education offering for non-traditional students looking to inspire open-minded, creative problem solvers who want to make a difference in the future. And it's come about through a partnership by King's College London, Arizona State University, and University of New South Wales, which is in itself, you know, an enormous achievement to be, you know, at such different corners of the world, and coming together to create a whole new learning opportunity for designing and engineering. And the emphasis is to inspire, disrupt, and transform. And it's looking at creating innovative technology, embracing education, entrepreneurial graduates, and a whole new approach to education. And we're really embracing the non-traditional student, the type of person who hasn't had any siblings go to university, their parents may not have been to university, which is probably why I feel so at home here, because I'm one of those students. I didn't have anyone in my family who'd been to university. And remarkably, in my first year of university, when I was home for Easter, it's when I heard on the news about what the tragic story of Stephen Lawrence. And he was, it was a shocking, horrific experience to go through, because it was so close to my home, where I lived, being from Southeast London myself. So, you know, I really felt that that could have been potentially, you know, my own story. So in trying to kind of radically change that landscape of non-traditional student and reaching out to make them feel like they can join this educational journey, I'm really excited about that. And, you know, it doesn't have to just be in engineering. It can be that this similar model can happen in architecture as well. It's just simply that it's not currently existing. So the radical thing about this course is that it's looking at a whole range of really phenomenally important skills, business skills, as well as technical skills and design skills. And also looking at how we're interconnecting students with industry right from the day one, you know, connecting every single project to an industry related project. And it's partly one the reason why it's innovative is because this is the CEO. It's the woman in the picture, not the man. So we have a female CEO in our university. We have fantastic connections with British Land, who are doing a whole redevelopment project around the campus. So it's going to be like King's Cross Part 2 all over again. And this is what I'm responsible for creating. It's the Teddy London Learning Tree, which is a completely virtual landscape. We will have no lectures. There will be no spaces for people to fall asleep in the morning whilst they're kind of like, you know, catching up on their late night. They can just dip into everything from wherever they are and you know, do all of the learning independently or with friends. But the actual teamwork is going to be all done in groups, in projects, which is really exciting. So we're just literally taking students now to start in 2021. And I'll just show you briefly a really fun way in which we're trying to get around the virtual learning or the COVID situation. So we have this wonderful virtual place where you can come and see what we have on offer. And there's videos to show you about the overview of the course. There's videos with different lecturers we have or different academics who will be helping with the projects and the learning tree. And, you know, this is an example of just how radically different this institution is. We're really, you know, very forward thinking, and you can just literally go around this place and have a really good look and see what the place is going to be like and what you'll be entering into. I'll go back to my presentation now just to enter into a slightly different area, which was my other half of this year. And that has been looking at the junior end of starting into design, which is much more related to architecture and engineering. And Archimake, which I'm a founder of, is about kind of going into schools, finding children who love making and really getting them when they are still inspired and they're still enjoying school and they're really enjoying that kind of exploratory experience. And we have bursaries available for ethnic minorities and for girls to encourage that attendance. And we're really keen for corporate to, you know, make partnerships with them to help them with their CSR. Where we can meet that very well. We have a 90% female team, 60% ethnic minority, and senior leadership is currently 66% female. So we're really, you know, putting our money where our mouth is and just really going for creating new inspiring role models for all of our children. And we have some fantastic presentations every term where they're literally, you know, telling us about how much they're loving their drawings and they're really finding that extremely rewarding. And parents obviously come and they realize how amazingly capable their children are of doing architecture, you know, which some children can't say the word architecture, but they can do it. So that's, you know, a fantastic offering to share with them. And then each term we have these wonderful presentations where we give them a certificate of completion. And it's not only the children who graduate, we actually also have a graduate training program, and we encourage graduates or anyone with a background in architecture to come and share what they know, and they actually get trained to understand how to teach and how to put together a course and how to manage and how to, you know, get lots of work experience opportunities. And again, you can see that our profile of the team are just as diverse in terms of ethnic minorities and female led. So all of these children are getting really radically different images of what an architect is. And we are looking for new people to join for 2021 because we've just, you know, had a new cohort go through our process. So we're really excited about inviting new people to join us on the next journey. And we also have a keenness to make partnerships with practices, so you don't have to, we've been invited to sort of talk to practices about how to run their own summer schools. It's like, you don't have to run one, we can help you, you know, just partner with us and we can make that work. So that can meet people's needs in terms of CSR. And this Saturday we have our presentation, and it's going to be online because many schools are still in lockdown. So it'd be really wonderful if anyone wants to join us, find us on Eventbrite, and we'd be really happy to to enjoy sharing that experience with you, which is always a massive highlight. We have guest panels so that we have a little kind of special professional input to children's presentations. And that's great. And I have got a little video, but I don't know if I've run over time.
I think we don't have time, Cheryl.
That's fine. If you want to see anything, it's all on our website, and be welcome to join and have a look.
Well, thank you so much, Cheryl. Very interesting to hear all about Teddy. I mean, that puts a completely different spin on where we're going with inclusivity, and that seems like a marvellous place to start. So at this point, let me hand over to Seyi Alabi. Over to you.
Hi, I'm good everyone. Sorry, Elizabeth, can you just hand me over the slides? There's some slides which I want to show. If I can get them up.
Here we go.
Hi, so my name's Seyi. I'm a director of a company called Camper Construction. But I do come from an architectural background, but in recent years, I've been working for a construction company. My journey is up until 2009, I was working in architecture practice. I found I was not getting relevant experience on sites. I feel that this is a bit of an issue for anybody who is trying to qualify, because you kind of need site experience to qualify, because you need to understand how contracts are run. So I was given the opportunity early 2019 to be part of a startup construction company called Camprop Construction. It was started by my friends. They brought me on to be initially in a kind of architectural capacity to produce some of their stage four design work for some up and coming projects which they were working on. I've had the opportunity to obviously kind of come from architectural background and go into obviously the construction kind of domain, and work alongside developers, contractors, subcontractors, project managers. So this has given me kind of an insightful kind of experience. I just want to talk about a project which I worked on last year or so. So I work in, obviously, this is a project I did on detailed design for, which is Barton Road, Cambridge. Just trying to get the slide to move, sorry. This is a project I'm working on. Obviously, I have had the opportunity to touch, obviously, the subcontractors and understand some of the drivers of the different kind of stakeholders. So encouraging signs of representation. So as I walk around the site, I do kind of see encouraging signs of representation from the BME groups. I have met leaders of some different disciplines, such as structural engineers run by BME groups. Some leaders of one of our subcontractors, he runs all our electrical subcontracts, and it's encouraging to see groups from BME groups or kind of people from BME groups run some of these services and obviously have representation on building sites, because obviously essentially that's what we want to see in the future. I want to talk a bit about architecture as a profession. I did feel while working in architecture, it was kind of, I suppose, difficult to be heard sometimes, because when you did get an opportunity, you just kind of got on with it and was not always given a voice and a team. So I found while working in construction, I suppose I am obviously one of the directors of Camprock Construction, so I have more opportunity to kind of use my voice. And I want to talk a bit about construction post-COVID. So I think in the past 10 years, we've had to deal with the aftermath of the credit crunch, Brexit, and now the COVID pandemic. I think in the era that follows these events, there'll be a sense of urgency. And I think it's in that small window that opportunities will be available for individuals who are willing to grab them. One thing I have observed while working with other kind of members of the construction team is they don't suffer fools. So standards do need to be high. And I think gaining relevant experience will give individuals the opportunity to gain confidence. And I think kind of individuals of BME groups do need that experience to be able to understand the process and obviously eventually gain confidence and improve standards and obviously get to where they want to.
You've got about a minute left, Shay.
Okay, so I think I've touched this a bit. Role models. I encourage individuals who do have the voice to use it. Obviously, research has shown that people from BME groups don't always talk or speak up and be heard when they're part of an organization. I think this is sometimes fear of criticism or fear of people rubbishing their ideas. We all make mistakes, and I think sometimes you just need to talk and just get your voice out there so people know that you exist. And obviously, any mistakes you do make, you learn from them. I just want to talk about architecture getting stronger and diversity in 2021. I'm encouraged by opportunities of 2021. I believe there will be opportunities for those who want to search out for them. I want to finish off by saying there are many routes into building. You can work with contractors, you can work with developers, you can work for house builders. It's all valid experience. It enables you to understand the place, your place in the profession, and all these entities facilitate the delivery of buildings. And obviously that's what we want to do as people in architecture.
Thank you so much, Shay. Thank you very much. That was really very insightful. I think for those who are in the profession and are looking to go beyond the RIBA part one and are having challenges finding experience, this might well be an opportunity and a route. At this point, we now go straight into our Q&A questions. I see that we've got Helen's on the call, and she sent in a question which I thought I should put to the panel, which is, what should our individual or practice New Year resolution be? Who'd like to go first? Sonia, would you like to take that one?
Sure. Take me on. Yes, and I'll be very quick. Make sure everybody gets a moment. New Year resolution, I think for me, would be internal reflection. Take a look over your shoulder, and as speedily as you press the blackout button on that fateful Tuesday, challenge yourself. Should I have? And what do I need to do to be proud of what I'm doing to make sure that the built environment not only really promotes and helps those from inclusive backgrounds, but as Femi said, that we must encompass social mobility with that as well. But self-assess, ask yourselves the question of what you need to do and where can you seek help in order to realize the dream, if you will, of making inclusion something which we almost don't notice, but that which becomes a part of our everyday practice.
Absolutely. I'd like to see it become a norm. Femi, what's your view?
Firms like Helen's are already walking the walk. Okay. Firms like mine, we're doing it, but we're small, right? And I suppose the larger firms are already starting, you know, as I said, there's been a lot of internal reflection. Even if we can say, yeah, we're doing all right, when you really look at it, how all right are you doing? Okay. What is the gender parity? You may have people from other backgrounds in your office, but where are they in that organization? Have you unconsciously promoted someone else above someone because they looked like you rather than because they're doing the better job? Okay. And if you can honestly look at yourself and say, yeah, I'm doing all right, then you look out. Because for me, you've got to sort out what's at home first and foremost. Okay. You know, as my mother was, charity begins at home. Sorry for those. It's a poor Yoruba accent. And I joked earlier that everyone, when I try it, they say I pretend they think I'm an Igbo man. But anyway, but look within. Okay. Know thyself. And if not, because it's the right thing to do, very soon it will become a financial imperative. Mm-hmm. You will not get onto a framework, a public sector framework, if you are not able to demonstrate, you know, that you preach, that you practice what you preach, that if someone opens your website, they are going to see, if you're in a London practice, they're going to see London represented on your website. Okay, give those who are slightly younger the opportunity to shine. Okay, listen to those younger members. Okay, they are closer to what's happening on the ground. Okay, you may have founded that practice, and therefore, yes, you deserve all the riches, but you're not going to be there forever. Okay, and it's about the succession planning. And if you can try and leave your firm in a better place than when you started, because of the fact that you've actually got the best people to do that job, that when you do have a design problem, that you've got people from a different backgrounds looking at that same problem, and their lived experience will affect your design solution and may actually end up being the winning solution, that's when you start getting the gains. Yeah. So that would be my advice. And as I said, some firms are already walking the walk. Okay, it's those that believe that there isn't a problem and that, you know, there's that little bloke from South London busy giving it, you know, those are the ones I think they will die. You know, as Darwin says, you know, it is survival of the fittest, those that make the change. Yeah.
Thanks very much, Femi. I'm going to ask a comment from Cheryl on this one, and then we're going to go to a different question with Sumita. Cheryl, would you like to comment? Can't hear you. You're on mute.
So I'd be very happy to comment. Thank you, Annette. I feel very much that what would be really helpful for society would be for new connections to be made. And so if there is an opportunity for you to, with all of your ability and knowledge and experience, see someone in your sort of further away in your network, not someone you would normally connect with, and you could just see, maybe just have a coffee with them and say, what is it that, how can I help you? What do you need? What do you feel blocked by? Or what do you feel you're struggling with in maybe your career or your, you know, your choices available? Because I feel like the worst thing about the kind of networks is that all the really valuable information is shared within a very, you know, a very tight-knit group. And if you're not in that circle, you will maybe never know what you should have done when you went into that meeting with your boss, or, you know, when you were given two options and or maybe even you weren't given two options, but you should have been given two options, you know? So it's just not knowing what you don't know. And I think that everybody learns about these things and they think, God, why didn't I have somebody who could tell me about that earlier? So if there's somebody you feel, you know, maybe has potential, or just someone who seems nice, you could just, you know, start helping those who really don't expect it. You know, they're not somebody who's always putting themselves forward. It might be someone who's shy, and just, you know, try to bump up the ones who are on the edges, to try to give it more opportunities to those, you know, who have a lot of potential but haven't found how to express themselves.
I like that, because actually I think that's a very simple, very easy action that every single one of us can actually you know, embark upon and try to do to make a difference. So I'm going to go on to, because I'm conscious of the time, to Sumita. We have another question here, which is, are there cultural reasons why people from minority communities are more inclined to put themselves at risk or be at risk in the workplace? Sumita.
Hi, sorry, I'm just unmuting myself. Yeah, I don't know about, I can talk about Asian culture, and we have this tendency to try and please. And I'm sure, you know, other minority ethnic background also have this tendency. And we overdo stuff, we overprepare, and, you know, just try and please everybody. And I think that can work to our detriment. And when I was looking at the COVID statistics, we lost a very well-known doctor. He was from an African background. And then we also lost someone who was a porter. He was white. And looking at those two things, there was nothing that was common between those two men. One was getting paid a good salary, and the other one, was a porter. But I think the thing that came through was this element of trying to please people. And we try and do our best, and sometimes that doesn't help us. So I talk quite regularly on radio, and this is a little exercise I've started doing. And I used to like make all my notes and read out stuff from them. And now I've stopped doing that. I just talk and I say what I want to, because I felt I was being constrained by making the notes and, you know, by constraint by writing, and just I wasn't letting my authentic self come out. So I think we have to be a bit, we have to protect ourselves too. You know, we try so hard to please. So let's just protect ourselves. Let's protect our integrity. Let's protect our authenticity, and let's protect our health.
Yes, yes, indeed. There's another question which I'd like to put to our panel. And again, it sort of touches on the one I've just asked Sumita, which is, should people from minority communities have more concern for their welfare as opposed to their jobs? And because I think these two are very tied in terms of the commitment that, you know, people, shall we say, people of color sometimes feel have a pressure on to perform. Would anyone like to take that question? Femi.
Depends on the need, I suppose. Depends where you are in your life, with your finances, with your responsibilities. You know, how much, quite often, you know, it's necessity. And it's those that have a choice and have alternatives. Those are the, you know, that then limits your risk. You know, those of us who are, dare I say, are privileged and can still work in exactly the same way, albeit not in an office, do so without even thinking about it. But if you've got to, if you actually have to go out there, you've got to get from home to your place of work, and then you have to interact more frequently than someone else, then yes, you are putting yourself at risk. But you know, if you have no choice, what do you do?
Well, yeah, I think that's where the community perhaps has a role to play, but we can't legislate that here, I suppose.
We can't legislate that, but you know, in terms of areas of society and what you do based on your on where you are in society, it just, you know, you, if you are in that bracket, that means you have to commute. You have no choice. You cannot work from home. You cannot have three screens. You do not have super broadband. So people won't even know whether you're in London, Croydon, Lagos, wherever. Yeah. Okay. You know, then you have to physically be there, which means that you're putting yourself at risk.
That's right.
Okay. And, you know, the NHS workers, the first few that died, other than those who had an existing condition, were mostly health workers because they had no choice.
Yeah.
You know, teachers having to go back into school when they have no choice because it was decreed, you must go back, we need to teach the children. They've got their own families, they've got their own children. What do they do? Mm. You know?
Yeah, it's a difficult one. Well, look, I think I don't want us to drag on for too long. What I'm going to do is one, I'm going to ask this one question. And what I want is for each person to just give me a sentence, kind of keeping in mind about this idea of the New Year resolution that Helen Taylor came up with few jobs and opportunities available, how can students and young people be supported in this climate? What can the RIBA or we do to support young people? And if I'd like to start with, Sonia, if you could say what you think in a sentence, and I'll just go around the whole panel.
I'm going to answer this slightly differently because it's what we found the evidence this year is that surprisingly, they can be the most incredible help to each other. The peer-to-peer support and guided support. And one of the things we did was offer them the facility to actually to challenge what Femi was saying about access to networks and software and so on. And the most incredible way of coping that they can help each other with is one of the most very simply achieved and powerful ways that we found helped, and they can help each other, and they did.
Oh, fantastic. I'll just go in order. Seyi? Can't hear you.
Hmm.
We can't hear you. We can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Mm-hmm. All right. I want to second. I think it's really important to get in networks. I think the opportunities I've been given in recent years is through my networks, people I've known for many, many years, and it's really key to cultivate your network, because fundamentally that's where your opportunities will come. So kind of use people.
Thank you, Seyi. Cheryl?
Hi, Annette. Yes, I believe, and similar note to the both speakers before, network is the most valuable offering. So if you feel like there's an opportunity for you to get people together and facilitate that via virtual or WhatsApp or some sort of common theme, then do it. And every single different network has a value, and cross-dissemination of your ideas is really the only way in which we move forward as a human race. So I would strongly recommend just start a network with some group and see what happens.
Hey, that's a good one. Sumita?
Yeah, sorry, I'm unmuting myself. So I think our education system pushes you down. You know, the crit system makes you people, I know, even, lots of very strong people start crying after a crit. So if you have young people working in your practice, just do the opposite. You encourage them, celebrate their work. You know, let them show their drawings, have mentoring. A lot of the part three students I work with, they're just left on their own. They don't see their mentors. So if we can encourage these young people to actually think for themselves and also, you know, celebrate, ask their opinions, make them feel valued at work.
Thank you so much, Sumita. And finally, Femi.
So I was proposing a radical idea. Well, it isn't radical really, because it happens, say, in America, but, you know, universities should really build up their alumni, architectural schools, you know, and actually every architect has gone to a school of architecture, but how well connected is that architect with where they studied? Even if they just started by going back to where they studied and actually saying, do you know what? We want to help, because the harsh reality is we are in the midst of a temporary recession. People are being made redundant. Senior people are being made redundant. But actually, if you're part of an alumni and you can therefore get students to be in that network, by the time that they start looking for work, there's an easier route. So that would be my one-line suggestion, even though I spent 3 minutes trying to explain it.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, Neil is about to get our party started, but before we do that, I'd quite like to get his final word on that, because he works a lot with young people. Neil, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. I totally agree with what everyone was saying, that yeah, networks are the biggest thing that people can do, connect to each other. And I think what we have to do is set up this sort of parallel network, not necessarily try and get into the mainframe of the system, but once we got these parallel networks going and these infrastructure going, then we can connect with each other and work with each other. And you'll soon see how the people who have the power will start to try and feed into those networks. Because as I say to many people, it's about power, control, and money. And they're the major three sort of steps that they're really interested in. They're not necessarily interested in the statistics, which are really good, that come out all the time. I mean, really good and really bad in a way, that come out all the time. They're not interested in those statistics. They're not necessarily interested in engaging in with people of different religions, creed, colors, sexuality. They're just driven by the sheer fact that money, power, and control determines their whole ethos. And if we set up parallel systems that basically care about people, love people, value people, celebrate people, if we set up systems with all that, we will be even stronger than them, because we will have loyalty. We'll have people who come back to the fold, people who are willing, like someone was saying, to help another young person and another young person. And that's how the chain gets stronger.
Thank you so much, Neil. Well, let me introduce Neil before we go into that. Neil is founder of Homegrown Plus. He has taught in several of the inner city schools for over 25 years and has worked with the London Open House. He's a trustee of the Stephen Lawrence Charitable Trust for the past 15 years and is currently head of product design at Graveney School in South London. There, he's introduced architecture to the curriculum, winning various open house competitions and being honored as a Teacher of the Year. He's also recently been given an NALA, which is the New London Architecture Award, and he's kickstarted Glam Goes Global, which is another architecture young student workshop that he's been running this year. Over to you, Neil.
Right, party time is here, and this song, literally, everyone who is over 25, and I expect that some of you are over 25, yes? You would remember this song. I want to hear your hands up again. Femi! What is it, Femi? He's the first one does.
Candy, drop it.
Yes!
Come on, my selector, rewind and come again.
Here it is.
Yeah, we know this one.
Right, hold on 2 seconds. Right, this one.
Oh, Boney M.
Yes. Yes. You've got it.
Boney M. Fantastic. Do you know she lives? Do you know the lead singer, one of the sisters, lives across the other side of the park from me, Neil?
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
Tell her we bigged her up at Christmas.
We bigged her up at Christmas. She'll love that. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And this one.
Not here.
That's here. Where is the love?
Yes, Femi. Hey,
Femi, you know you had, I can tell you had this other life.
Oh, really? I have many lives, but music is one of my loves, so.
Right, this one.
Oh yeah, Rapper's Delight, 1979, number one.
Rapper's Delight.
Hang on.
If there's a buzzer, I'm buzzing first time.
I'm gonna have to put Femi on mute, yes? Right, here we go.
Let's dance, David Bowie. I love that. Mm.
Yeah. Next one. I can't hear.
Oh.
Give it all you got.
Give it all you got.
No.
Oh, is that?
It's not called that.
There's no need to tell you. There's two versions because there's one that took, there's one from Mary J. Blige. Yeah, it's Kenny Burke, and then Mary J. Blige took the riff.
Yeah.
And it's on the album, What's the 411?
Yeah. That was Rising from the Top, Rising to the Top, Kenny Burke.
Yeah.
Rising to the Top.
Did you hear that one? Let me turn it up. Right, you ready? I played just a second of it. Everybody knows this one, I think.
That's James Brown. Get off the floor, is it? It's James Brown.
Oh yes, you're right, James Brown. Yes.
So far for that scene.
Oh yes, I know the one. Yes.
Yeah. Get up
off your
whatever.
Get up off your feet and make you feel better.
This one. You may not get this, Femi.
If you're going to use songs post 90s.
I can't hear it.
We can't hear.
Oh, that's Stormzy. And it's Stormzy. What's it is?
Shay, you asked for post 90. You should get that. You asked for post 90. Where were you? Where were you, Shay? Where were you?
Was it? It was Stormzy, but I can't remember the track.
Yeah, that was Stormzy. Yeah,
you didn't get that one.
That was Do Better.
Do Better. Yeah.
Right, this one.
Yeah, I know that one.
That's an old tune.
Sorry, I had to hit the oldies. The oldies over 25. So what was that one?
I can't know.
Grazing in the Grass.
Wow.
Do Better, Keller.
Hold on, Neil.
Annette, are we going to allow our guests to have a go at guessing?
Yeah.
I'm going to stop for a while. I'm going to put my hat on instead.
We can unmute the voices of our guests. Elizabeth.
Yeah. All right then. And I'll put on a couple of ones that they may
Everyone can unmute.
If everyone unmutes themselves and then we promise to be quiet for the next few.
Okay.
Yeah, because I think Sonia and I, this is our time. We were doing all right. I'm going on mute. I'm gonna stop now. Let some guests.
All right, come on. Let's listen. Although we won't allow it for long. If you're all not getting them, we're coming back.
If you take longer than 4 seconds, we're jumping in.
We're coming back.
No, I've played it. Come on, guests. You must get that one.
That was too quick.
Thank you.
Any takers on that one?
Gosh, even I'm struggling. Femi?
Play a little bit more, Neil.
I'm fine.
What, it's so short, can't you? I don't know that one.
Yes, you do.
Is it Daft Punk Around the World?
Which one?
Daft Punk.
Oh, yeah. No, around
yeah,
the world.
He's got it. Well done, Shay. Oh, yeah. Shay, he got it. Yeah.
Oh, my Lord.
That's on.
Oh. Now look. Here we go.
Yay.
Oh, got one.
That's right. I was instructed that it had to be gold. And I think I've hit the mark.
Mark right on.
I'm very impressed
there, Sonia.
As you can see, I'm wearing a Nigerian Christmas hat. I got the gold. I got the instructions of the gold bit. So
I love it.
But I don't have a hat, but I do have a glass of wine. Does that make up for it?
Well, I think that more than makes up for it. Yeah, more than makes up for it.
Cherylyn,
that's Cherylyn.
Yeah. Got to be real.
Yeah.
Nice.
Oh, yes. Jump.
Dum, 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 right, has everybody got their party hats on yet?
Yeah,
we have. We've got them on.
Right, I'm going to play a bit of British now.
Good.
Oh, loose ends hanging on the string.
Loose ends hanging on the string.
You guys are too sharp.
You know what?
Too sharp.
Hang on, I'm going to put some house music on. I mean, what other people, because some people are feeling a bit overwhelmed by Femi's and...
Well, they wanted... You've got to go... Femi, I think you'll agree there. You've got to go... Where is it, Shay? You said sort of above 2,000 or something. You know, you've got to go...
Yeah, remember, I've got children 17 to 30.
I know.
15
I
to 30.
Say,
so I'm having to listen to theirs as well.
You know, this
is still rocking. You were still rocking Stormzy. You've got it all. Yeah, yeah.
You know.
But well, I don't know any of this music because I come from India. So I'm going to play a music which is actually quite diverse. It's an Indian who's singing, trying to be pretending to be Jamaican. And I think you know this song.
Okay. Boom shakalak. That's Apache Indian.
Yeah.
Apache Indian.
Yeah. Is that Apache Indian?
I thought that was
Shaggy. Oh, maybe.
No.
Oh, I know that one. Yes.
Boom shakalaka da 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 da.
What's it called though? I don't remember the name. Is it Boom Shakala or something?
I think it's called that. Yeah. But who is it? I don't know. Who is it then?
You're back on
is
mute.
Is it Apache Indian?
You're back on mute, Sumita.
We can't hear Sumita. We can't hear you.
Sumita, you're back on mute.
Yeah, he calls himself Apache Indian. Apache is, American.
Yeah.
I think he means it in an ironical way.
Okay.
Right. So anybody got any other ones?
I've got a really brief one, which is very alternative.
Go on.
Okay, I'll try and do it short. I don't know how to. I wasn't planning on doing this. Okay, so right, let's go.
Here you go.
Oh, he just told you what it is.
Which one?
Hold on.
Okay, right, there you go.
My motivation and my passion. Oh yeah.
Lovely.
Lovely.
I'm gonna cheerleader. He's one to
Okay, well,
right, so how long we got left?
Just a couple more minutes and then we'll have our vote of thanks and our closing.
All right, then. So what I'll do, listen, we've got to have this one. And it's, wait there, let me see. It's one that you can all sing along to. I opened with it. So here it is. I put my hood up. Remember, last words, David Cameron said, cuddle a hoodie. Where's my cuddle?
Well done. Well done, Neil. Okay, well, we're coming close to the end now. I'm going to ask Femi to give our vote of thanks. And then our surprise guest is Albert Tucker, and he's going to do the closing. He's the chairman of Karma Cola Foundation, supporting communities in Sierra Leone. He's the director of the Renewable Energy enterprise linking renewable energy and people living in fuel poverty. Albert is also an EU expert advisor on diaspora engagement and policy. He's a pioneering figure in the fair trade movement and an active global player in community regeneration and sustainable development. He's got a strong track record in leading and building successful enterprises. And he's also working with us as one of our directors as well for our mass housing project. So over to you, Femi, and then Albert will do the closing.
Thank you, Annette. I do want to take this opportunity to thank everyone that has contributed to this evening. First and foremost, Sonia, thank you once again for making the effort to come back, this time virtually. So you can say that you've done it both in person and virtually, but the effect is still the same. Lots of energy, lots of positivity, and that you are actually, you know, the voice for some of us in trying to make that change. It's fantastic to hear that more young people are coming to this profession through organizations like yourselves and others out there. I'm also cognizant of the fact that, you know, as a result of the events of this year, more firms aren't walking the walk, okay? And therefore, the hope is that when we do get back to situation normal, it will continue. I believe it will, because I think public consciousness, social media, it can't go back as to where it was. But we must be aware of these small microaggressions, the unconscious bias that happens. And even in circles where you would not expect it, you do. And what I have always done is that when you see it, when you hear it, you call it out there and then. Don't wait, don't go home, don't let it fester because you've lost the moment. You've got to address these issues immediately. And, you know, quite often, you know, as we've said, racism isn't, you know, it's taught, okay? And therefore it can be untaught, but only it can only be untaught if someone is actually brought to task over those matters. It's great to see that there's models of representation and how we're trying to demonstrate our inclusivity with the firms that are out there, those that have taken it seriously and are probably in a better position financially to start doing it. But, you know, I think as Seyi said, taking control of one's own destiny, you know, I was brought up, no one's going to give you anything for nothing, right? There may be opportunities that you do not know. You may be lucky, you may fall into a job, and sometimes you may have to create your own luck. It is possible. Yes, it's slightly more difficult, but as you can see, Seyi has done that. And then there are other things that you can do within our built environment. You don't have to be an architect. The built environment requires architects, it requires engineers, it requires quantity surveyors. So this, you know, Teddy London is a fantastic vehicle for people from non-traditional backgrounds who are cognizant of potentially spending the best part of £35,000 to get a degree. You know, do not think that there's only one route to market. And more importantly, you know, next year, if we all inwardly look over Christmas, get our house in order and then move forwards and start supporting the young, the mentoring up and down, you know, the young people do have value. They may even teach you some of the songs that I've been listening to. Thank you, Neil, for making me feel young again and old at the same time. And thank you to Elizabeth for her help and Franchetta, and for those of you that are on here, I wish you all a very merry, blessed, holy Christmas and a very prosperous and healthy new year.
Thank you very much, Femi. Thank you so much. And Albert, now over to you.
Oh, hello, everybody.
You got your camera on.
I've got my camera on, and I have to apologize. My technology has really challenged me today. So I missed a little bit of the beginning, but I think for many of the people here, I've heard on some of these topics before. So it was really glad to listen. And that's what I would say. If you've recorded that last bit, the party games, I think you should publish that. that will be a very inspirational session and a very educational one for a lot of people, because they would all have seen you in your serious and professional capacities, but they see the people, the smiles, the laugh and the warmth in all of that. So, and I much appreciated that, and I was tempted to jump in a couple of times, but I thought I'd preserve the dignity of the occasion as well as enjoy the hilarity of the occasion.
Yeah, but you made this look bad. You should have jumped in, Albert. You made it seem as if all I do is
I was enjoying, let me put it that way. We have to do that as well. We have to enjoy and celebrate, as friends have reminded me. I don't have a hat, but I do have a glass of wine. But I have to say, recently I was talking to some people in Watford here where I live about some of our early achievements as a Black community. The Black community in Watford is a small but old-established one, a mixture of African and Caribbean. When we had some crisis here where I was very helpful in mobilizing the community, I realized something, which is we don't get together, we don't build. And it's something I learned in Ladbroke Grove. One of the criticisms people of my generation who were working there, of ourselves, was we didn't build anything. That's why Ladbroke Grove now doesn't belong to us, it used to. But we didn't build anything, we didn't leave a legacy. We as Black people didn't deliberately own and build things. And I think going forward, that's something we really need to hold on to, because we built it for others. We set a platform for others, but for ourselves and our community, we didn't build so much because we were very much in the mode of contributing. And also, to be fair to us, fighting. My generation, we're fighting a lot just for the right to exist in many areas. You know, we actually built the thing of actually having the people who were supposed to be beneficiaries actually owning, working in, designing the policy of organizations. That's one of the things we did leave behind. I also look at the conversations about Windrush, and everybody's forgotten that those folks came here to put electricity wires on the ground, to build our NHS system. We don't tell those stories enough. We tell the stories of the suffering, but not those stories, because we don't have monuments to it. Not enough anywhere. I'm not sure there's one or two around. So what I would say about architecture, it's a fantastic platform for leaving a legacy and for building and for bringing our youth into it, and also for recognizing and acknowledging that contribution and that potential and that capacity. And I think that's the wonderful thing I draw from this. Also, equally, in Watford, which I started with just now, what we learned was that because we didn't come together enough, people didn't give us enough respect. At that time, I was of the age where the biggest thing in my life was playing and watching football. So naturally, what would we do? We created a football team. made of not all black people, but at least two people who were not black, who were white, who were very close with us. So we had a team where there was a vast majority of black people, which people were not used to. So when we hit the pitch, it wasn't like when two of us played in a white team and something kicked off. It was us against the rest of the white people, and our white colleagues would stand back. Now, there was at least 10 of us who were going to engage. And weirdly, people were scared of us as a result, because this was a body of black people who were organized and who were doing things. And I tell you, I've never appeared in front of a court as much as I appeared in front of the FA tribunal by people trying to get rid of us. But also, with cool and what capacity we have, I was a union representative, so I had those skills. So I went forward and defended us, and they never managed to kick us out. And that was a lesson for me. Often we are isolated. And I was telling Annette earlier about my daughter, who wanted to be, from when she was 5, wanted to be a doctor. And she was brilliant. I did a deal with her about if she stayed in the top 5, I wouldn't interfere. Very smart kid, my daughter. And she actually made sure she did, and as well as enjoy life. And then when she got to choosing a university, she thought the best university. She had the results. She was in the top 5% in the country. And because we didn't know the sector, we hadn't engaged with people who were in the sector, and we were well-informed activists at that age, she didn't get the clinical experience she would have needed to get into one of the top universities. And if you could ever beat yourself up, or as my mother would put it, slap yourself up the backside of your head, that was the moment for us. And luckily, UCL, which is one of the top for medicine, had a policy of the top 5% will automatically get an interview. And she, of course, she blew away the interview, and she was there, and she's a senior obstetrician now, working her way to being a consultant and working with problem pregnancy. And furious as ever that black women are still more likely to die or lose their baby in pregnancy than white women, about 4 or 5 times more likely in this country, and working with that. So I think there is a real, for me, what's fascinating and really fantastic about hearing this and the work that Let's Build is doing, is looking at building that platform where we can encourage our youth to know there's this support network here, all of these people, organizations, institutions you've all been talking about. Sonia talked to me about her passion about Stephen Lawrence. It wasn't his death that was the telling thing. He wanted to be an architect, and he was doing everything he was doing about towards that. And therefore, Stephen Lawrence should be focused on that, because that was a positive, and let's build from there. And Sonia, you're doing that, power to you. And I think that goes for all of us, to actually make that platform apparent, make young people know they can come and be supported and get knowledge. And my Latin American colleagues have a phrase which they say when we talk about capacity building or support, they call it acompañamiento, which means walking with us, so that we will walk with them to get them there, because that's what it will take. And it's an impressive body of people I'm hearing here. I know there's an even wider body of black people in all aspects. I think Femi, was you that was saying, in all aspects of the industry. And part of why I'm working with Annette as well on this new one, Abule, is also we need it in Africa, and I know it's needed in the Caribbean as well. And so I think it's a global thing for me. And hearing you all, and you all far, far more knowledgeable and better practitioners at this anyway than I am. And I'm very impressed by it. And I hope we can get the message out again, as my Latin American friends like to say, another way is possible. And I think that's what I draw from this. And let's build is appropriate. Let's build a legacy. Let's build that future. But let's also show, when I came into the enterprise sector in the 80s, people used to tell me, black people, particularly Africans, they can never work together. I'm glad to say I don't hear that anymore. But I will say we still do need a lot more of it for us to build our institutions, to build our legacy, to build our platforms. And otherwise, they're stolen from us. And our young, and our youth, and our people. So I really liked what I heard from you all, the parts that I did hear, and some of the real inspiration and aspiration you are presenting. So I have to say, I've really, really enjoyed just listening, and that's not always easy for me. So for me, it was nothing more than, it isn't always easy for me. So I was enjoying the experience of actually just listening to a bunch of damn good Black people talking.
Thank you so much, Albert. This has been terrific. Thank you, everybody who's been on the panel. Thank you so much, Sonia. And I think at this point, I just to say a good night, and let's look forward to 2021. And you know, charge your glasses and cheers. Till the next
cheers.
Time, we meet again.
Cheers. Until cheers. Next time.
I'll play us out of a song, and it's a classic song by a classic guy, and it's a bit old.
And now,
Frankie, you know we do it our way.
The final curtain.
The final curtain.
Good night. Good night, everyone.
Good night, everyone. Yeah, take care.
Bye. Bye. Bye, Sumita. Bye, Cheryl. Bye, Neil.
Bye, Femi.
Bye, everybody.